Hello, everyone. This is Mrs. Dragoo, and today we're going to discuss jazz and musical theater dance, a brief history. This is important for all musical theater artists to understand where our musical theater dance originated and how it has evolved over time. Now, you know what I like to do before every lesson? I want you to get comfortable and put away anything that's distracting, and let's take a few minutes to breathe deeply. Take a deep breath in through your nose. Let it out through your mouth. Again, in through your nose. Let it out through your mouth. This is good for focusing. Again, in through your nose. And let it out through your mouth. All right, you should be focused and comfortable. You should have nothing around that will distract you. So put away your phone if that's what you have next to you. And let's get started. Our objective today is for you to be able to recognize major jazz dance works, jazz styles, and jazz dance artists in history, and how those artists helped evolve musical theater to the dance form we have today. So the origins of dance is found in the rhythms and movements of African dance brought to the U.S. by slaves. And as slaves, Africans were cut off from families, languages, and tribal traditions, which was awful. And slave owners, which was even more horrible, forbade drumming and African dancing. But the slaves found ways to express their cultural identity by stamping and clapping and making rhythmic vocal sounds. African Americans created new hybrid forms of dance that blended elements of the new and old cultures. Eventually, these dances evolved into what we know as jazz dance. Some characteristics of jazz are that you have bent knees and a low center of gravity. You have body isolations where one part of your body moves alone, syncopation, pirouettes and high kicks, movement emanating from your torso and pelvis, percussive movements, jazz shoes. Jazz in the 1920s. I just love this photo, and sometimes I wish that I could go back in time and visit the 20s to see them dance. Everyone danced in the 20s, social dances. After World War I in the 20s, jazz dance and music became a big part of the American social scene. Everyone knew how to dance, and when they would gather together, they would all dance. Dixieland jazz music was popular, along with the Charleston. That's the first use of isolations in social dance. And then partnered social dance to jazz music was a popular dance of the era. Bill Bojangles Robinson was a master tap dancer of the 1920s. He's an important figure if you're a tapper, and if you want to go on and study musical theater in tap, you need to know who Bill Bojangles Robinson was. Jazz in the 1930s was the time of Duke Ellington and Louis Armstrong and big bands. This was also a time that well-known dances at the time were the jitterbug and the boogie-woogie, and you guys, everyone danced in the 30s. The guys and the girls all knew the dances, so when they got together for a social occasion, they would dance together. Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire danced in many famous movies during this time period, and jazz music and jazz dance were inseparable. You did not have one without the other in the 1930s. Now, after World War II, we enter the world, after World War II era. This put a stop to the popular social dance scene. This is a picture of Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. Although we did have jazz music evolving into what we call bebop, which was rhythmically complicated and hard to dance to, so you didn't have as much jitterbug, you didn't have as much of that social dancing. Jazz dance moved from the dance halls to the stage, becoming prominent in Broadway shows and movies. And jazz dance became influenced by ballet and modern dance as it became more professionalized. Jazz choreographers developed specific techniques in this era to train dancers specifically for shows on Broadway. Catherine Dunham was one of these. She was an African-American dancer who studied towards her doctorate in anthropology. She researched Caribbean dance and brought vocabulary back to the United States. She rekindled an interest in Black roots of jazz dance, and she had her own dance company and dance technique. She also was a famous choreographer on Broadway. In 1939, her show Tropics and La Jazz Hot was an immediate hit. Eventually, she established a school for dance in East St. Louis. You need to know Catherine Dunham. Mid-century, this is what we call golden age. Let's talk about the musicals now. In 1943, Oklahoma marked the beginning of dance as a major part of musicals, and it was choreographed by Agnes DeMille. Remember, Oklahoma was the first musical play that incorporated dance. Singing in the Rain was incorporated by Gene Kelly in 1952, starring Kelly and Debbie Reynolds. You all know the tap dance numbers in that one, especially the one in the rain. West Side Story was choreographed in 1957 by Jerome Robbins and was also known for his work in ballet. He was a very famous ballet dancer, and that's why West Side Story is heavily ballet. Musical theater choreographers blended jazz with other dance forms to create dances that worked for specific stories. Oklahoma, Singing in the Rain, and West Side Story are an example of ballet, tap, jazz, all of those incorporated into specific musical theater types. There's a picture of Oklahoma and a picture of that fun tap dance number with Debbie Reynolds. Singing in the Rain. Donald O'Connor, Gene Kelly, and Debbie Reynolds, only 18 at the time, starred in the 1952 classic movie about the early days of talking pictures. Dance, including tap, soft shoe, and ballroom, played a large role in this movie. The title number shows Kelly kicking and splashing in the gutter during a downpour and brandishing his umbrella and jumping on a lamppost to express exuberance. This is probably one of the most famous musicals of Gene Kelly's because the movie was what made it so popular. It's hard to do on stage because you have to have a rain effect, but the dancing is incredible in this musical. Jack Cole is known as the father of the jazz dance technique. He developed an innovative training technique using body isolations and movements borrowed from Eastern culture. He choreographed for film and Broadway, including the shows Kismet, Man of La Mancha, and Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. He also served as a movement coach to Marilyn Monroe and many other actors. Luigi. Luigi was a famous dancer in the 1960s. He developed his technique as a result of a car accident, which left him paralyzed on the right side, and doctors said he would never walk again. But operations and physical therapy and his own dance technique brought him back to health. His technique requires extreme muscle control and grace and is influenced by ballet. In his youth, he danced in movies, including Singing in the Rain, Annie Get Your Gun, and White Christmas. He's known as a master teacher rather than a choreographer. I want to show you a video clip of Luigi doing his original pre-warm-up. Notice the slow movement. Make extreme muscle control necessary to keep in form. And notice here that his warm-up, or pre-warm-up as he called it, is slow, smooth jazz. Little ballet. Isolation of the shoulders. So in his master class, Luigi would start with this pre-warm-up every day. Here's what it looks like in a more modern dance class. I have to get to the play, but. So this might be a good warm-up that you learn and maybe teach in your class. We're going to move on to the next slide and talk about Bob Fosse. Bob Fosse was one of the famous American, probably one of the most famous American choreographers. He performed in vaudeville and Broadway beginning as a child. He became a famous in the 1970s for show like Sweet Charity and Chicago. The movie All That Jazz was about his life in the fast lane. And there was a movie recently, or a series recently, about his life and the life of he and his wife. His first director won, and he was the first director to win an Oscar, a Tony, and an Emmy all in the same year. And his style has also been called slick, erotic, and intense. Here's an example of a scene from one of Bob Fosse's musicals.
Who's that with Vittorio?
She doesn't look familiar.
Who can she be?
What happened to Ursula?
Who is it? Who is it?
Who is it?
Who is it?
Who is it?
Who is it?
Who is it?
It's me.
Wow. This place sure is crawling with celebrities. I'm the only person here I never heard of.
Thank you.
can tell, Bob Fosse has some really intricate, smooth, and sexy moves. Let's move on to see a little bit of Bob Fosse himself.
Bob often talked about his limitations as a dancer. But if you look at film of Bob dancing,
this is why Quinn Burton talks.
What are the limitations?
He's also a dancer.
Movie that Bob choreographed was Kiss Me, Kate. Not the entire movie. Hermes Pan was the choreographer. And Hermes always said, you just have a way of dancing. So why don't you choreograph your own piece? Mostly with himself. He didn't need siblings. He had his own sibling rivalry built right in. The alley dance. Bob loved it because he could compete with a ballet dancer, and Tommy Roll was truly fantastic.
I showed you those so that you can get an idea of the way Bob Fosse choreographed and how he danced himself. So let's talk about jazz music and dance. Most jazz choreographers today work with the current popular music, not jazz music necessarily. Jazz dance has mostly separated us from its original source. However, there are a few jazz choreographers who believe that jazz dance should be done to jazz music. Let me move my screen here. Danny Brzeski says that jazz is such rich music, I don't use it as atmosphere or background. The music is the subject matter. Billy Seinfeld says that jazz dance must have swing, which is a syncopated rhythm, accents on the offbeat. He says that jazz dance must be judged towards jazzness by the same criterion applied to jazz music, its rhythm, not the melody, and not the harmony. As a proponent of the swinging jazz dance, I feel that this yoking of rock music and jazz movement constitutes a paradox. I am interested in challenging this practice. His company is the Jump Rhythm Jazz Project. Mia Michaels has her own company, Reality at Work, called Raw, and she choreographs musicals. She's toured Korea, Europe, and the U.S. She has a unisex style which sometimes requires women to lift men. And she uses huge dynamic range, ear-high extensions, and ballet leg beats. Twyla Thorpe, I like her quote here, creativity is a habit, and the best creativity is the result of good work habits. She's a choreographer and director of Movin' Out on Broadway with the music of Billy Joel. And it's about a group of friends as they move through the decades to Billy Joel's music. It was named Best Show of the Year by Time Magazine. She also has her own modern dance company and is choreographed for ballet companies. She's choreographed for films including White Nights with Mikhail Baryshnikov and Gregory Hines and the movie Amadeus. She's been awarded 17 honorary doctorates in dance. Susan Stroman, she directed and choreographed Producers, which won the Best Musical in 2001. She created Contact, a Broadway musical based on the three stories told in dance. She says, every step I do is plot-oriented. So for Susan Stroman, the dance tells the story. She's also choreographed for the Martha Graham Dance Company and the New York Ballet. This is one of her favorite quotes. I tell stories through dance, and I think that's why I'm so attracted to theater, because even the choreography in theater moves the plot forward at all times. And that's the key to musical theater and dance. Savion Glover, in 1996, at age 22, he created Bringin' the Noise, Bringin' the Funk. That show traced the history of Black Americans, including slavery, chain gangs, and street life. But it didn't have a plot or characters. Dancing was the primary focus of the show. He is a tap dancer. Musical theater to dance today is still strongly based in jazz dance, although other influences are also apparent. You can see ballet, you can see hip hop, you can see all dance forms out there. There are many varieties of jazz dance today, including African, lyrical, modern, and rock. Jazz dance has responded over the decades to the needs and desires of those doing it, from social dance to professional performance. Related trends like breakdancing and hip-hop have also been influenced by jazz. Jazz dance remains strongly linked to the popular music of our time. So let's review. Jazz dance originated in the African-American vernacular dance of the late 1800s and mid-1900s. With slow-growing domination over other forms of entertainment, music and jazz dance evolved on Broadway into a new smooth style taught today known as modern jazz. Tap also continued to evolve on its own. Knowing the history of jazz and musical theater dance will help you better understand the history of musical theater dance in the United States. It's enjoyable. Dance gives you physical fitness, artistic expression, and training as you pursue musical theater, because all musical theater actors have to be able to sing and dance and act. So knowing a little bit about where our art form originated will help you in an understanding of the art itself. Here are some of my references, along with some YouTube videos that I looked up. I hope that you enjoyed this presentation. I challenge you to get out there and dance, move, and make sure that you're moving your body. One cool thing that you could do is look up the Luigi pre-warm-up and learn it so that you can teach it to your friends. Another cool thing is look up Savion Glover and learn one of his tap dance combinations to teach yourself and to teach your friends. Have a great day.